Hello, today I'm going to make a large Wimshurst machine. The other day in my channel, I suggested making a Wimshurst machine for the summer science project. In that video, I mentioned that I would make a larger version, but I haven't had a chance for a while. Now I finally made it. This time, I'm going to make a machine that is larger and more efficient than the one I made in the previous video. Let me show you. It discharged. Let's get started. Let's briefly review the structure of the Wimshurst machine. The Wimshurst machine is a device that collects an imbalance of charges on the surfaces of each disk by using electrostatic induction accumulated in the Leyden jars and discharges. For a detailed explanation, please watch the previous video. There is a link in the description. The discharge distance of the device I made in the previous video was only 3 to 4 millimeters. But this time I will aim for a longer discharge distance using this book as a reference. The target distance is 20 centimeters. In the first place, what is discharging? Here it doesn't mean the phenomenon that occurs when you discharge a battery. It refers to the phenomenon where high voltage is applied to cause the dielectric breakdown and a current flow. Discharge has four main types: corona discharge, glow discharge, spark discharge, and arc discharge. Let's start with corona discharge. It's a discharge that occurs, for example, at the tip of a wire or pointed areas. It's a continuous discharge. Next is spark discharge. It refers to instantaneous discharges like static electricity and lightning. Next is glow discharge. This is a discharge used in fluorescent lamps and similar devices. It's a continuous discharge. And finally, arc discharge. It's an extremely high temperature discharge used in processes like arc welding. Among these types, the type of discharge caused by the Wimshurst machine is a spark discharge. I would like to use this simple Leyden jar to show you a spark discharge. When you store charge in a Leyden jar and bring it closer, it discharged just now. This is a spark discharge. Let's have a closer look. We need to accumulate the charge here. However, the charge naturally leaks out from these pointed areas due to corona discharge. Therefore, by minimizing corona discharge as much as possible, we can increase the voltage stored in the Leyden jar, which allows us to observe a long-distance spark discharge. Based on this idea, let's see how we can improve the device I made in the previous video. I think there are three things that could have been improved. The first issue is insufficient generated voltage. This is simply due to the low power generation capability of the device I made last time. And the second issue is that there were many parts that caused electrical resistance, such as thin wiring and joints between wires. And the third issue is that there were many pointed areas in the machine as I hadn't given much thought to the shape of the machine. As a result, there were many areas where corona discharge occurred, which allowed charges to escape into the atmosphere. By solving these issues, we should be able to observe a larger spark discharge. I came up with several measures to improve the power generation efficiency of the machine. To generate more electricity, we need to either increase the rotation speed or the surface area of the disks. It's quite difficult to rotate an object at a high speed, so I decided to increase the surface area for this experiment. This is the disk I designed. It uses FR4, a glass epoxy commonly used in PCBs. Therefore, it should have a high insulation performance. It's less likely that it experiences insulation breakdown even under high voltage. These are copper foils. I think the shape of the copper foils can also affect the power generation efficiency and the way discharge occurs. I made even more various improvements, including the rotating mechanism. I will introduce them as I assemble the machine. Now, let's actually start making the machine. First, we'll begin with the discs. As you can see, there is a large cutout hole in the middle. Here, I will attach a hub that also serves as a driven pulley. It looks like this. There is a groove carved in this part. I will hook a rubber belt here to drive it. I made two discs that are exactly the same. By the way, I made this driven pulley and hub using a 3D printer. Most of the parts used in this video were made by a 3D printer. I wanted to make the rotation as smooth as possible, so I decided to put ball bearings in the hub. They are on both sides. I will put the shaft through the hubs. With just this, the discs can easily move and the bearings may come off. Therefore, I will attach collars to secure the discs. The disc part is complete. It rotates smoothly like this. The smoothness of rotation has improved significantly compared to the last time. Next, let's assemble the base. This time we decided to use PVC pipes for their high availability, good workability, and low cost. And I also made the drive pulley part for driving the discs. It consists of a hand crank, a shaft, a bearing holder, and drive pulleys. It rotates very smoothly. I realized again that bearings are essential for rotating parts like this one. I'll fix this driving section on the base. There's one thing to note. Make sure not to forget to attach the drive belts, as it's difficult to attach them later. By the way, we decided to use urethane belts for the drive belts. It's because you can create a loop of any size by welding the cut ends using a lighter. The pulleys with the handle are secured. Now let's move on to securing the pulleys on the discs. It's difficult to put in. And then it's complete once you hook the belts onto the pulleys. Let's actually rotate it. It's spinning quite vigorously. It's rotating pretty smoothly. Even when I turn the handle at a high speed, the discs don't wobble so much. However, as the discs themselves are not completely flat, I can hear a slight sound of the discs rubbing against each other. Next, I made neutralizers. They are wires for transferring the charge accumulated on the discs. I made two and secured them to the PVC pipes. I also made collectors for collecting charge using 3D printed parts. I passed the wires through the parts and secured them to the pipes. These are Leyden jars I prepared in advance. I connected the wires of the collector I made earlier to the jars. The machine is completed. Now let's try running it. It's spinning. I was watching the recording on a display just now, but the display went off due to static electricity. When the machine is running, I can hear crackling sounds. Also, I can smell the ozone. This is a rod for discharge. Let's bring it close. It's good. Let's try again. It can discharge continuously. I'll try to increase the rotation speed even further. It seems that faster rotation leads to quicker charging. The speed of discharge is getting faster and faster. However, the discharge distance isn't good. It's not as long as I expected. I thought it would be a bit longer. The discharge distance is only around 2 centimeters at most. I tried filming the discharge in slow motion. The discharge distance is probably around 2 to 3 centimeters at best. I was able to test the functionality, but the discharge distance was not as much longer than the previous machine as I expected. When you bring the discharge rod connected to one Leyden jar closer to the other Leyden jar, a discharge occurs between the rod and the jar. However, it seems that discharge is also occurring on these discs. I could smell the ozone while I was turning the discs. Maybe corona discharge is occurring somewhere. When I actually checked, corona discharge was indeed occurring. This is a video of the neutralizer when the discs are rotating. It is experiencing corona discharge. It's discharging almost regularly. There is also discharge occurring between the copper foils on the discs. Furthermore, discharge was observed at the collectors as well. What this means is that when the voltage of the Leyden jar is high, discharges occur in places where we don't want them to, such as on neutralizers, collectors, and discs. If discharge occurs in such places, it's difficult to increase the voltage of the Leyden jar any further. It's because the charge that was supposed to be used for charging keeps escaping. To increase the voltage of the Leyden jar and extend the discharge distance, we need to do something to stop the unwanted discharges in these areas. However, preventing discharges becomes more difficult as the voltage increases. It's because when you raise the voltage, discharges occur in other areas. Even if you take measures against the discharges that already occurred, when you raise the voltage, discharges will occur in yet other places. Taking complete measures is quite difficult because we end up playing a cat and mouse game. I tried various measures. First, I made significant changes to the neutralizer. I changed it to T-shaped wire. Stranded wires were used at first, but we changed it to solid T-shaped wire. To suppress the corona discharge that occurs when the voltage increases, I minimized the number of sharp points as much as possible. As for the shape of the wire, it ended up in this shape after some trial and error. With the first design, the discs and the neutralizers were in contact in this way. However, through repeated experiments, I realized that the discharge distance is longer when the neutralizers are not in contact with the discs. So we changed the positions of the neutralizers. These neutralizers with the new design are positioned so the edges of the neutralizers are slightly away from the discs. We also made some improvements to the collectors. As a result of various tests, we found that collectors with pointed parts collect charges more efficiently. So we haven't made any major design changes. We just changed the wires. The first prototype used stranded copper wires, but the new one uses solid copper wires. Solid wires are easier to handle. The discharges between the collectors and the Leyden jars is a significant challenge. It seems that a structure where the collectors are directly connected to the Leyden jars is the closest to the ideal, but this time we will proceed without making significant design changes. It's completed for now. Let's actually run the machine. I'm turning the handle, but it seems that it is not generating electricity. It's probably due to the significant changes in the structure. We need to initially provide a charge imbalance. Rub the acrylic plate with a cloth like this. Bring the plate closer. Then a charge imbalance occurs and charging begins. I can hear a buzzing sound from the machine, and there is a smell of ozone. It means corona discharge is still happening somewhere. Let's see how much the discharge distance has become longer.
Ooh.
It became quite a bit longer. I think it was about 10 centimeters, wasn't it? This is also because we made significant changes to the structure, but it seems that once the machine discharges, it will be completely out of charge. No charge is left in the machine. So after discharging once, you need to rub the acrylic plate again to generate charge imbalance. This is a bit of a hassle.
Ooh.
I filmed the discharge in slow motion. I compared the discharge before and after the improvement. Before the improvement, it was 2 to 3 centimeters. After the improvement, the discharge distance has significantly increased to about 8 centimeters. Let's see how long the discharge distance has become after the improvement. The discharge distance became around 5 to 10 centimeters. As the voltage is quite high, I won't be performing dangerous experiments this time. Once this device discharges, the charge will be completely depleted, so you have to apply a charge imbalance to the disc again. It's quite a hassle. I wonder. There's no charge imbalance, but residual charge was still in here. I got zapped pretty badly. Please be careful. I have been using plastic-laden jars, but I will try using glass ones. Let's see what happens. I have changed the Leyden jars to glass ones, but not so much has changed. The discharge distance hasn't changed much. The strength of the discharge hasn't hardly changed. Let's try once again. There wasn't really a significant change after all. The discharge distance hasn't changed. The intensity of the discharge hasn't changed much. I think rather than the Leyden jars, the discharge distance is more affected by the design of the discs, collectors, and neutralizers. I'm holding a fluorescent light right now. I'm bringing it close to the Leyden jar. Can you see? It's glowing. I can feel the little electric shocks in my hand. I feel like all the hair on my body is standing on end. Today, I made a large Wimshurst machine. I aimed for a discharge distance of 20 centimeters, but it was difficult to achieve. The maximum charge distance we could achieve in today's experiment was about 10 centimeters, and the maximum voltage was probably around 100,000 volts. I can think of various reasons why the discharge distance did not increase, including structural issues and environmental issues. As for environmental issues, since we were shooting in a humid season, it was difficult to generate static electricity. We used the aircon to dehumidify in this room, but it could only do so much. I think the results might be a bit different if we perform the experiments in a dry environment. As for structural issues, there were several of them. First, the drive belts here. It looks like driving without a problem, but actually the belts were quite slippery. The discs became larger and the power generation capacity increased. Because of that, an attractive force was generated between the discs due to electrostatic induction. As a result, the discs were stuck together and were not spinning properly. Additionally, as the voltage increased, more corona discharges occurred on the discs and pointed areas. Corona discharges occurred at the Leyden jars as well. These discharges were not expected. Because the charge leaks out, the voltage will not increase beyond a certain level. It seems that further measures are needed regarding corona discharge. However, as for the discharges that were occurring on the discs, I think they can be reduced by adjusting the arrangement of the copper foils. When I was reading this book, I found that there is something called a sectorless disc. Can you see it? It's an acrylic disc. The discharges that occur on the discs can be reduced if we replace them with this sectorless disc. A sectorless disc seamlessly performs positive charging, negative charging, and neutralization by charging the resin. Currently, we are making a sectorless Wimshurst machine using this acrylic disc. Today's results were not very satisfactory, so I will use this sectorless disc to achieve longer distance discharges. I'm aiming for 20 centimeters. I will upload a video about the sectorless machine sometime. So today I made a Wimshurst machine. Thank you for watching.